Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the Kennedy Center. Our afternoon panel is being presented at the 5th Annual Mary Lou Williams Women in Jazz Festival. My name is Penelope Williams, and I'm from Atlanta, Georgia, and Georgia State University. I'm a professional musician in that area, the region of the United States, and it's a pleasure to be here. I wanted to let you know a little bit about my relationship with Mary Lou Williams. I didn't have the opportunity to meet her, but she has had a profound impact on my life as a musician, a woman, a teacher, and a mentor. Her life's work in music, the development of her musicianship while touring with vaudeville shows in the Andy Kirk Band, resembles sort of the years that I spent touring with commercial shows, although I wasn't the primary arranger. I was the lady who swings the band, as the title goes. Mary Lou Williams extended herself in music as a means to express freedom from human limitations and bondage to conforms. I too relate to this driving force and also to the desire to develop this opportunity in others, not as a means of escape, although this can provide respite, but from the confines of daily living, music offers one-on-one connection with the divine. Thank you, Steve, as yet intangible. We're driven as musicians, I think, to circulate ourselves among society and in part to inform people of the culture they hold within themselves, to lift them up to express. This was Mary Lou's mass, Mary Lou's life purpose, as far as I see that in my relation to her music, her quest, all through the doors of music, to enhance life, illuminate the spirit, and exalt the soul. Now, Mary Lou's early influences we'll begin to discuss later on as we go. I wanted to introduce first Dr. Tammy Lynn Kernodle. She has recently completed her third year as assistant professor of musicology and Black World Studies at Miami University in Ohio. Tammy Kernodle holds a Bachelor of Music degree in music education and piano, a Master's of Arts in musicology, and a PhD in musicology. That's a tall task. Her dissertation is titled Anything You Are Shows Up in Your Music, Mary Lou Williams and the Sanctification of Jazz. It was the first work of significance on the religious compositions of Williams and has earned her a reputation as an emerging scholar. She has lectured extensively on the music of Mary Lou Williams, including the International Jazz Educators National Conference, the National Meeting of the Association of American Catholic History, and recently the Charlie Parker Symposium in Kansas City, where I had the privilege of also being on the panel with her. That was a great event. Last year, she served as a consultant for National Public Radio in their participation in the National Cathedral performance of Mary Lou's Mass, and is returning as a panelist for this year's festival. She's currently working on a chapter in Garland Press's upcoming anthology on Black women musicians. Her piece will deal with the impact of race and gender on the careers of early Black female jazz instrumentalists. Certainly that's a very timely topic, and we appreciate her being here. Her publication should be out in early 2001, and a monograph of the works of Mary Lou Williams. Thanks for being here, Tammy.
Thank you.
Kimberly McCord, Dr. Kimberly McCord. That has a nice ring to it. Congratulations. Well received. She received her doctorate in music education with a secondary emphasis in music technology from the University of Northern Colorado. She has so much experience in teaching and providing a mentoring role for women in jazz. I met Kimberly many, many years ago, and she was already providing that support for women in jazz. She is the founder of the Women's Caucus for the International Association of Jazz Educators, chair of the Educational Outreach Committee, chair of the Strategic Planning Communications Committee, and coordinator of general music for IAJE, and I don't see how she does it. She's quite busy. She's been writing numerous articles she has mentioned, and I'm sure she'll share that with you as well. She has been a writer on the history of women in jazz with publications including American Women in Music Since 1900, the New Grove Dictionary of Jazz, which is our Bible, the Jazz Educators Journal, Jazz Educators Research Journal, and numerous others. And she has been invited to contribute an article and participate in the Smithsonian Institute's Sung and Unsung Jazz Women Concert Symposium in the New York City, October 1996. She has a lot of information for us on education as well, and Mary Lou as an educator, teacher, and mentor. And Linda Dahl, our third panelist, is here. She's the author of Morning Glory, which has just been released on Pantheon Books, and we're so pleased to have you join us. Yeah. It's receiving rave reviews in our country, and we hope that you'll find it on your bookshelf soon as well. Morning Glory is a biography of Mary Lou Williams, And she's also, Linda has written many articles about Latin American culture and music, especially bossa nova. Numerous CD liner notes and works of fiction, including the forthcoming novel Colorblind, as well as the acclaimed history of women in jazz, Stormy Weather, which is on Pantheon in 1984. We all have that. Her next book project will treat another very important woman in jazz. Oh, reveal that mystery. And Colorblind, that sounds very interesting. I wanted to address you as a biographer, Linda. It's much like an archaeologist, I think, uncovering an artifact, turning it over and over until you illuminate its relation with the whole. What were the significant mentoring themes of Mary Lou's life?
I looked up mentor in the dictionary because I wanted to make sure I knew what I was talking about for once. And I found that, interestingly, mentor is a Greek term originally. And mentor was Odysseus's trusted counselor. And so this is where we get the meaning of the word. And wise and trusted counselor or teacher was the meaning in my dictionary. And it doesn't appear as a verb, but we've made it into a verb. We tend to do in the English language, I guess. And, you know, Mary Lou Williams was probably, above all things, this definition fits Mary Lou Williams. A wise and trusted counselor for many people, musicians and non-musicians. But she was not an easygoing one all the time. She, who was born with perfect pitch, great time, I think it was Dr. Taylor who said she had a built-in metronome, and an extremely fertile musical mind, respected others enough to expect the best of them according to her definition. And not surprisingly, she was disappointed at times for various reasons. Yes, this was a woman who was given the nickname Pussycat, and as a musician pointed out to me, cats have sharp claws as well as soft fur. And at times she could be quite tough. But, you know, she had really learned to be tough in her teen years especially. The way she came up in amateur shows through vaudeville and then in the big bands. She was bothered in her early years of performance by near paralyzing shyness. And she herself wrote and recalled how her first husband, John, a saxophonist, would resort to threats, and sometimes more than threats, to get her to get up and play when she was overwhelmed by her stage fright, I guess you would call it. The school of hard knocks, literally. So she learned toughness, and she was aware also that she could be rough on others. As one example, she wrote in her diary in the late 1950s about a bass player she'd hired who was a longtime friend of hers. For what was then a rare public appearance, she wasn't appearing much at that particular point in her life, wasn't taking too many nightclub jobs. And she was in a club in Toronto, and she wrote that she regretted losing her temper with him, adding that this happened to her when she knew that the musician in question was coaching. To her, this was unprofessional and unacceptable. I think the one thing she couldn't abide was an unprofessional attitude on the bandstand. So she used to say, I was trained to play with everyone and play everything. And what I find incredible is to recall how she would talk about how she learned to transpose because she would have to play on pianos that were broken down. And so she would find the key that was best suited for that particular piano. Remarkable way to learn how to play. You know, although Mary certainly, in a general way, gained musical education in the schools in the early 20s in Pittsburgh, where she grew up, on the other hand, she was left alone by her teachers as a kind of prodigy or wonder kind. And I think probably because, like a lot of musicians who have a very, very good ear, oftentimes children will fight learning how to read music. And they'll even fake that they've learned how to read music. I've seen this with one of my own children. And so it takes rather a patient teacher to keep at them to have them learn music. This was not the case for her. She did not learn to read music until probably the late 1920s, when she, and this might be a form of mentoring, when she asked bandleader Andy Kirk to teach her how to write down the music that she heard in her head and that she had been dictating to him all along. Excuse me. When she was probably 9 or 10, there was a local pianist in East Liberty, her Pittsburgh neighborhood, called Jack Howard. And in her words, he taught her how to bear down and play heavy like a man. Howard and Earl Hines, of course, were men. Fats Waller, another primary influence. And I shouldn't leave out Art Tatum, who specifically she wrote about sitting and watching him play and him teaching her certain runs in the mid-30s. But there was at least one woman who I think we could count in this group, and that would be Lovie Austin. And Lovie Austin is a sort of legendary figure about, to this day, I don't think too much is known. She wrote for, directed, and played with the Vaudeville Pit Band Orchestra in Chicago. And Mary Lou wrote more than once about the impact on her it had of seeing this woman in this position, a strong female figure at the keyboard. She started teaching, that is, taking in pupils for pay, when she was in Kansas City during the Depression. She wrote in one of her notebooks that she and her friend Bill Basie, not yet Count, were sort of giving each other students. And she enjoyed this very much. Then in the 1940s, she went in several interesting directions as a teacher. She worked in an informal capacity with some of the emerging musicians, later legends, like Bud Powell. And I think it was, again, Dr. Taylor, who was a presence on the scene, who recalls her saying to him, "Left hand, Bud, left hand." You know, she had learned from the masters about how to keep the rhythm with the left hand, and she felt this was something that he and others needed to not neglect. Powell was often in the company of Thelonious Monk, a huge admirer of Mary's, and that influence, I think, again, cut both ways. His influence can be heard on her music, especially in the later 40s and early 50s. Unfortunately, much of that music is not available on recordings, though it is, my goodness, available on at the Institute of Jazz Studies, where her effects are housed. And her influence on him also was marked, especially in terms of specific musical ideas that he, and I might add others, incorporated into their own pieces. One example, many have heard Rhythmining, and that was taken from the second chorus of her Walking and Swinging. And there are numerous other examples. In the 1940s also, Mary did something I think typically very far seeing, and that was she wrote and approached New York City's Board of Education about teaching jazz in the public schools. Now, surprise, the Board of Ed turned her down, but she was continuing at that time to develop her thoughts and ideas, including on paper, about the African-American musical heritage and the continuity of it. She was a very, even then, very cognizant and very sensitive to the importance of the different eras of the music. And she began to see at that time or feel the urgency of passing that on, that sense of heritage. Jazz became, I believe, linked for her with passing on the heritage, specifically the historical and psychic underpinnings of the music, what she herself said was the suffering of the slaves that shaped spirituals and the blues. So that her teaching had as much to do with an awareness of the history that in turn shaped an aesthetic approach to the music as it did with specific aspects of
pianistic technique. In fact, I think she often felt that that was a matter of hard work and application on the part of the student. One example of a pianist in the 60s who credits Mary Lou with being a tremendous influence and teacher is Hilton Ruiz. And he has talked about how he took private lessons in her Harlem apartment, and she would be frying chicken or cooking fish in her kitchen right next to the living room where her old, scarred, three-quarter Baldwin upright was housed. And from time to time, she would call out some observation about his playing, but she rarely stepped away from her stove because it was his job to figure out how to fit the harmonies into his jazz conversations.
As I call it.
A little bit later with bassist Brian Torf, who was then just coming out of the Berklee School of Music, she took him on as her bass player at the Cookery. And she got very upset with him because he didn't know the standards. And of course, this was unacceptable. And she made him really go back to school, as it were, and relearn some of that repertoire. And finally, at the end of her life, from 1977 until she became too ill to teach in about 1980, Mary Lou Williams was the artist in residence at Duke University. And this was, I think, the crown of her career. She taught flocks of college kids who had never heard jazz before. Her classes in introductory history of jazz were filled all the time. And one of the things she did was have them sing along with records from the different eras of jazz in order to start training their ear. And she also taught a lot of private students. They couldn't have been a more diverse group. She had established players who wanted a master class or two. She had a rock musician who became intrigued with jazz through her class, and he went on to become an activist priest. She also gave lessons to a white, middle-aged housewife with a heavy hillbilly twang, who became a very good friend of hers. They all became close friends of Mary Lou Williams and were transformed by their lessons with her. It was, I think, equally the force of her personality, her presence, her aura, the example she set, as well as her powerfully swinging, deep musical guidance that inspired these musicians and others. Thank you.
Thank you, Linda. Excellent. Excellent overview. It's just, and Linda will also be available after our panel to sign and autograph her book, Morning Glory. So we thank you so much. And it's, Mary Lou was a musician, you know. It's just, she was a musician who shared this, and her innermost being was a musician. Tammy, I think Mary Lou, music gave her freedom and connection with people, to lead people away from suffering through her music, and I think automatically of her masses later in life as she composed her masses. And that is your expertise. Can you share with us your thoughts about Mary Lou as a mentor through her music, her masses, and your experience with that?
Well, I think most important to remember is that during the 1960s and the early to mid 70s, she was really crusading very hard to change what she saw was America's destructive popular culture, and part of that being related to rock music. And so she set out on this musical journey almost to really bring people closer to the sacredness of jazz and gaining new audiences for jazz by taking forms that traditionally would not have been linked to jazz, being that of the sacred liturgy of the Catholic Church. And she and her manager, Peter, really went on an active crusade during the 60s and the 70s to educate people about jazz, but also to provide for them social commentary through music that, despite the difficulties of life during that time, because that's one of the most chaotic periods in American history, that there was peace to be found. I mean, I think that is what makes those works so important and so poignant, making peace and wonderful music out of chaos, but still providing such a powerful message of love, you know, through jazz. But in terms of her as a mentor, you know, in my work, looking at her specifically, I've seen her mentor many women throughout her career. And we typically, we know the stories of her and Monk and Dizzy and those people. But also in the 40s, she was making a series of recordings. And it's a debatable whether she really wanted to make those recordings or not, with several all-female groups. And these recordings are very important because in many cases, this is the only evidence that we, that we have of some of these women existing on the scene. Drummer Bridget O'Flynn, bassist June Rottenberg, women who were playing instruments that were conceivably not seen as appropriate instruments for women. And she, you know, was making these women in jazz recordings, sisters in jazz, and some of them had some odd names, Mean Mothers, you know, you've seen these recordings. But that unofficial mentorship, because she put these women in the context of jazz history, which was something that wasn't happening. And is only beginning to happen, that women being excluded from serious discussion of jazz history and what they were actually doing on the bandstand. But I think, in particular, after her conversion and after her self-imposed exile, you see two very strong and very important relationships being forged between her and two significant black female jazz performers, one being Melba Liston, trombonist and arranger, and the other being Carlene Rae. Melba Liston, their first encounter, 1957, Newport Jazz Festival, Mary Lou's first performance when she comes back. And one of the many pieces that is being played with the Dizzy Gillespie Orchestra is an arrangement of three movements from the Zodiac Suite, and this arrangement is Melba Liston's, who was trombonist with Dizzy Gillespie at that time. And if you know anything about jazz history, you know there are very few female jazz trombonists. Janice Robinson and Melba Liston, of course, initially come to mind. I mean, we've got a whole generation now. But, I mean, this is significant for Melba Liston to be in Gillespie's organization, but also for Gillespie to trust her enough to arrange for him. And they almost have a similar experience in that Melba is one woman within an organization of many men and making her way. Now, their experience is somewhat different in that Melba's initial welcome into this group is not very hospitable. And she proves herself. But I think there was some kinship there between them, the two of them. But what we see from that point on is during various periods in Mary Lou's career from that point, Melba Liston is there. She's arranging or she's conducting for Mary Lou Williams. And I'm a firm believer in letting music speak for itself. So I want to play for you a short excerpt from that Newport Jazz Festival performance. She actually arranged two movements of the Zodiac Suite. If you're not familiar with the Zodiac Suite, they were written in 45, and they're symphonic, 12 symphonic poems based on zodiac signs. And Mary Lou redid them various times in combo, in piano settings. But this is a short excerpt of Melba Liston's arrangement of Mary Lou Williams's work, and you're going to hear Melba Liston on trombone as well, just so you can get a sense of the type of talent that Melba Liston had. Thank you.
And this is Mary Lou herself on piano. So you can hear after even 3 years of not playing, Mary Lou is still back on her game. You know, not rusty at all. But Melba really scoring some very lush horn parts that really supported what Mary Lou was doing with her own solo. And Melba followed Mary Lou even in her exploration of religious compositions. And Mary Lou, in 1962, wrote her first religious composition, a hymn in honor of St. Martin de Porres. You probably know it as the Black Christ of the Andes. But in 64, she was included in a religious concert at Carnegie Hall called Praise the Lord in Many Voices. And for that concert, she wrote various pieces. St. Martin de Porres was featured on there. But she also composed another hymn called Amnia Christi, which is a piece that I love because it really shows Mary Lou's inclusion of blues element. I mean, she really got to the heart of it all because it sounds just like typical black gospel of the time, but in a jazz context. And for that performance, Melba arranged that particular piece and also conducted that piece. I want to just give you a little taste of that so you can hear the breadth of her arranging talent. Very sparse instrumentation. Thank you. But, I mean, just another example of her, of kind of being connected to Melba Liston. Finally, I'd just like to say, you know, also in the religious works, she used Carlene Ray, bass player and vocalist. And Carlene even talks about Mary Lou as one who inspired her to really keep with jazz singing. And she used Carlene on the recording Matt Music for Peace, which was the first recording of the religious compositions. And we of course, if you've heard this, you know that Carlene has a signature voice on Lazarus and the Our Father, very deep, soulful voice. I was going to play that, but we're out of time. But these two relationships, because she took Carlene Ray, a bass player and a vocalist, she took Melba Liston, a ranger and a trombonist, and used them extensively during this period in what has become some very important works in terms of our overall opus. But, you know, as endearing them as black women as well, having that kinship as black women, who these were two black women of probably many that were really trying to make it on the jazz scene, but her taking them by the hand and using them, not being condescending, but using them and exploring their particular talent.
And I love that idea, and thank you so much for sharing, and I look forward to your next book. And I really enjoy the idea of Mary Lou working within her context. Carlene Ray is quoted as saying she was most definitely about the music and getting people, especially young people, in touch with their roots, lifting their spirits and giving them hope for their futures through the music. She always enjoyed working with young people wherever she could gather them and teach them some of her mass, especially in her Harlem neighborhood. And I know, Kimberly, you think so much of Mary Lou as a mentor, as a role model. Can you speak to us about that and your experience with that? There's sort of a lack of Mary Lou in the school system in our country and the importance of that.
It's been kind of interesting as I talk to women jazz musicians now and people who have known great women jazz musicians, and I ask them, you know, who were their inspirations, who were their role models, who kind of kept them going, and Mary Lou's name inevitably always comes up as somebody that even inspires musicians now. It's really great. And Melba Liston is somebody that I talked to in the early 80s when she was writing a couple arrangements for me, and we talked a lot about the relationship that you were talking about, how Mary Lou mentored her so much and made such a difference. And Melba sort of took that mentor relationship on with young women, musicians. You mentioned Janice Robinson and other musicians that Melba recorded and helped to promote as well. And it, you sort of see...
Keep talking.
Okay. You can sort of see it start with women like Mary Lou and Lil Hardin Armstrong was another person who was really great about doing that. And you can sort of see the thread go through. So Melba Liston, and then Melba sort of instilled that in the next generation. And I think it really does continue, and it's kind of a really wonderful thing to see women in jazz being so supportive of each other. Something that I'd like to talk a little bit more about and was from a conversation I remember having with Dizzy in the mid-80s, when he said that there, in the early 40s in New York, when bebop was just sort of starting and there were these jam sessions going on that he and Charlie Parker and others were a part of, that there were sort of three places in New York where people would go to jam and to sort of work out ideas. And I think one was Minton's Playhouse, one of the clubs, and the Three Deuces. And then the other place that was really important was Mary Lou's apartment. And it sort of was like the French salons. There's this history in the country of France where sort of wealthy people would go to each other's houses and perform music, and composers would have a chance to share their music. And that sort of happened at Mary Lou's house. And I think she was giving her ideas to people and creating an atmosphere where that could happen. I think that's really an overlooked thing in music history of how important her apartment was, you know, for the development of musicians like Monk and Parker and Gillespie and others in the 40s. Sarah Vaughan, another person, really.
That was in Manhattan, or 52 Hamilton Terrace or something in Manhattan. So for you tourists out there, that's where you'll go.
Yeah. Mary Lou Shrine.
Although there is no statue or anything yet.
But really important
part of jazz history, I think, happened there. We sort of know from the education literature that it's really important for girls to have role models, and especially minority girls to have role models where they can see themselves actually becoming what they dream of. And I think Mary Lou Williams is a really important role model, and I really encourage music teachers to try to include Mary Lou in their jazz libraries. They have plenty of Ellington, they have plenty of Miles Davis, and those guys, which is important, but they need to make sure that Mary Lou's being played. In the gift shop, I collect children's books on jazz musicians, and I was in there looking to see if there is anything new, and there's lots of books on Duke Ellington for kids, and Louis Armstrong and those, and there needs to be one on Mary Lou. So I hope somebody will write a Mary Lou book.
Somebody is.
Are they?
A fellow I know in Baltimore, at least he was last year. Or maybe
a children's book?
Yes. That's all I can tell you.
Good, then look for it. If you know of elementary teachers, make sure they know about it when it comes out. And we look at girls in jazz bands, and we see that they are in the middle school jazz bands, and they're real active, and then by the high school, they start to drop out, and in jazz festivals that I've judged, maybe there'll be one or two, and then by the time they get to college, it's really pretty rare to see women in jazz bands, particularly women that play trombone or instruments that are girls' instruments. And I think having a poster in the room of Mary Lou, or better than that, being able to play her music in the jazz band, which again is going to empower women who want to compose and write for jazz band, would be really important. I think that her music could be played by some high school jazz bands, and it's exciting that places like Lincoln Center, Jazz at Lincoln Center, are doing this essentially Ellington contest where high school bands from all over the country play Ellington's music and, you know about him as a composer. And I hope that someday her music will be available as well. I hope that somebody will do a Mary Lou Williams website so girls can go on the computer and learn about her.
I encourage you to go to the Kennedy Center site and find out more about that.
And there are comments of Carlene Ray, that's where I got that quote, and D'Antoinette Handy, that's kennedycenter.org, I believe, or
kennedy-center.org.
And then you would go on to the Women in Jazz, Mary Lou Williams Women in Jazz site, and you'll find all sorts of interesting things. You can find former, previous workshops that have taken place. You can download through real audio some of the music. So, and that's a start for us. Isn't it?
That's great. I'm involved in a project of writing a general music improvisation method, and I was so thrilled when you played Anna Mae Christie, because that's one of the pieces we're trying to write an arrangement for, Orff Ensemble, and I think her music needs to be taught and performed by kids, and so hopefully, if this all works, my dream is to do a whole book of Orff Ensembles on Mary Lou's music, and it's perfect.
Okay, are there any questions? We'll yield to your ideas at this time, if you'd like to ask one of our panelists anything regarding Mary Lou. I'm pleased to see Mary Lou's family out here in the audience, as always. Very nice to have you here in Pittsburgh.
In terms of Mary Lou as a teacher, again, working with women, one is jazz pianist Sumi Tanuka, who's based in Philadelphia. Mm-hmm. And Sumi talked about calling Mary Lou, saying, can I take lessons? And this woman said, come on up. So we're talking about a teenager with her mother, getting on a train, and we weren't talking Metro Line then, and going up to New York City, then getting up to Harlem, and taking lessons. And one of the things she said was, Mary Lou talked to her about her touch, and she said, you know, getting out there and playing, she said, you have to get out and do it. That's where it's going to come to you, not sitting here and me talking to you. Another student of hers, bass player named Mike Taylor, who teaches at the University of Pittsburgh. Mary Lou made him come and play in her apartment. The other thing she did, she was part of an active intellectual group in Harlem, essentially a salon. And she told Mike to put on his suit and his tie and go and sit in those groups so he would be a better person and more well-rounded. So she was looking out for her students, male and female, and trying to develop them. And she just always told them to look their best, to do their best. So she was always a part of that. And just for further reference for tourists, Hamilton Terrace essentially was what was the backyard for Alexander Hamilton's farm. Back from colonial days, it's up the street from City College of New York and has now been gentrified as part of Sugar Hill and Harlem.
It's so exciting because as researchers of Mary Lou, I grow near and dear more so the more I learn about her and her wise ways, you know, and I love hearing the blues and everything she did. I mean, that's what I'm hearing, and there's such a great deal to learn about Mary Lou. We encourage you to continue to explore, and as everyone does, we all come away with different feelings about this. Another question? Comment?
I'm a neophyte in the area of jazz, but specifically in the area of female jazz players and performers, and there is no better panel than you to write what needs to be taught, because we don't have the access that you have to the information. And if you wrote it, we would teach it. But we don't have the kind of time that we used to have for research for unknown artists to teach our students, because it's so much more now that we have to teach other than just music. So we have to teach math, we have to teach reading, and it takes away from the music curriculum, obviously. But if you wrote it, we would buy it, and it would be taught.
There are a number of curriculum projects that are sort of popping up in different places. A real exciting one just came online this month through the Thelonious Monk Institute, which is at the University of Southern California. And it's web-based, and it's available 4th grade, 8th grade, 11th grade through the web. And there are recordings that you can listen to on the web, and lots of text and lesson plans and things for kids to do. And I'd encourage you to check that out. There's another project that's happening now is through Jazz at Lincoln Center, which is through the Louis Armstrong Foundation, and is a jazz curriculum project for elementary, middle school, and will be available to every public school in the country for free. And that's just being completed, so you'll be getting that. Recordings from the Lincoln Center. Not me, it's Lincoln Center, but it's great. It's going to be really, really neat. Yeah.
Can you talk a bit more about the Mary Lou Williams spiritual journey? I don't know much of her biography. I'm looking forward to reading this book. But I was very interested when you talked about her conversion and seclusion and the way in which that sort of fueled a new compositional period in her life. Could you talk about what that conversion was and how spirituality and religion played into her work a bit more?
I think, well, in 54 is when she actually leaves the jazz scene. But she eventually makes her way back to New York. She pretty much vows that she's not going to play and become a part of the jazz scene again. And it just so happens that the Catholic Church is the only church that's open all day in Harlem. And she goes to the Catholic Church to pray. And she's taken by the liturgy of the church, what she describes as the sanctity, the quietness of the church, and how Catholicism really kind of spoke to her in that hour of need. And so in 57, she and Lorraine Gillespie, I'm sorry, my mind is on Raising in the Sun, are confirmed together. They go through the confirmation together. And even then, she's still hesitant to actually really play.
And it was really hard was a priest who was instrumental in talking to Mary into getting back into the religion, that it was a gift from God, that so she should be back playing.
Into the music, that was actually her ministry.
Yes.
And that she could do, because she was very much into activism. And very much, I've talked to Catholic historians and say, and they say that she almost took on the lifestyle of a sister in the order because of the manner in which she prayed and the manner in which she conducted herself, that she almost took on the personification of a sister in an order, a Catholic order, or nun, what we would think of. But it is, it's her religious confidant who steer her back into music. And at this time also, we take into consideration historically, the Catholic Church is changing. Vatican II is happening, which makes it possible for the Mass to be performed in the vernacular. But it also provides the environment for new music to be composed and performed within the church. And so these people who are around her are saying, oh, this is your opportunity. You can write, you can save jazz, you know, by writing these religious pieces. And so the first piece is St. Martin de Porres, the hymn in honor of St. Martin de Porres, which St. Martin de Porres is the first Negro saint canonized by the Catholic Church. And it's a significant piece as well because there is a movement within the Catholic Church amongst blacks to integrate their heritage into the liturgy. And so she is a part of that movement toward that. And so from 62 up until 1970, and there are periods in which she's not writing Catholic music, she's writing masses, she's writing hymns. So there are four masses. The fourth is a rescoring of a third mass that is actually commissioned by the Vatican. So this was not someone who was just simply, oh, let me write some religious music, or I think this might work, I might sell a couple of records. You know, this was an extension of herself, extension of her beliefs, and it really brought, and I'm not gonna take up too much more of your time, I'm sorry, you asked the wrong person. It really brought, it really brought, peace within her life because she was having conflicts between her new spirituality and her love for jazz. So it really, you know, Vatican II is really important in terms of that, you know. But if you look at the history of the civil rights movement, it's all coming out of a theological perspective. It's all coming out of Southern black churches, Baptists, but Northern blacks becoming a part of the movement. And I think it's just significant that you have, it's even further back, go to the 50s, Horace Silver, Les McCann. You have these musicians within the hard bop, funky jazz movement, yeah, that are writing pieces that are based on the music, the nuances of the black church. You know, so there's a huge spiritual movement that's happening during that period. But she is doing something that's very unique in that she is altering tradition. In that the Catholic liturgy, she's altering the, and these pieces are based on Catholic liturgy. You know, she's not simply writing a mass to write a mass. They're based on the order.
Which separates and deepens her relationship with the church.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's different than just writing on top of something or writing a lyric to something. She created this music, and this was her language. And we appreciate you sharing your time with us this afternoon.
Mm-hmm.
And wanted to recognize another question, I believe, or a comment, please. The titles of the music that she wrote, the masses, the titles of the mass.
The first one is called the Pittsburgh Mass, or it's sometimes just simply called Mass. The second is Mass for Lenten Season. The third is Mass for Peace, and that was the mass that was commissioned by the Vatican. It is later rescored, and it's now called Mary Lou's Mass.
You can get the music to the Institute of Jazz Studies at Rutgers University in Newark. A lot of the music is there.
Newark, New Jersey.
And the limited recordings of the third Mass that she self-produced originally, and then with additional pieces for Alvin Ailey was choreographer for his company. So that's one, that's probably the only way really to hear that recorded music.
The recordings aren't available though?
The only at the Institute of Jazz Studies. Or unless somebody has a copy at home. Some people, very few people do, but that'll be it.
It's so enjoyable to discuss the music of Mary Lou, and we're sort of caught for time. I just wanted to express my deep gratitude for these scholars and loves that we share for Mary Lou and her work, and to her family for being here with us. And we have great respect for Mary Lou. And wanted to acknowledge Dr. Tamulin Kernodle, Dr. Kimberly McCord, and author Linda Dahl. My name is Penelope Williams. Thank you so much. Please stick around. Thank you.